I recently came across Australian rapper Takae Mizda and her song Awake, which is a slapper, by the way. If you haven't heard it, please go stream it. And when I scrolled down to look at the comments section, one of the comments I read said, "Punk lives through black women now. What an awesome moment." And I agree, it is an awesome moment. But this has always been the case. When we look at any trend, style, sound, attitude, and even language that reaches peak popularity at some point, its origins can almost always be traced to black women. The blues was a style of music that was derived from jazz, which predated rock and roll. The sound was pioneered by black musicians, and the ones who often come to mind are people like Howlin' Wolf, Muddy Waters, Chuck Berry, Little Richard. But the real stars were the women, people like Ma Rainey, Bessie Smith, and Big Mama Thornton, whose single You Ain't Nothin' But a Hound Dog got catapulted into popularity when it was covered by Elvis Presley. And most importantly, let's not forget that we wouldn't have rock and roll without the gospel singer Sister Rosetta Tharpe, a black woman. So punk isn't just living through black women now. Punk would not exist without black women. But because of the historical erasure and the systemic racism permeating so much of the culture, the contributions of black women unfortunately go largely unnoticed and unacknowledged. To quote singer-songwriter Tamar Khalee Brown in the James Spooner film Afropunk,
being caught in a system that you can't identify with, that you don't support, and like just being contrary. That's the true energy of what punk is. Like, I think one of the most punk angst people I could think of in history in a lot of ways is Nina Simone, you know what I mean? Like, sometimes people think it's like a certain thing that they can put in a box. It is a feeling, and so many people can encompass it, you know. It doesn't have to be some stereotypical Sid Vicious as like the poster person for punk. So I definitely think that it's a state of mind and just a way of life.
When 1978 rolled around, the most important punk band of all time, in my view at least, released a colorful, dystopian-themed, postmodern sci-fi album that satirized the world and the direction it appeared to be going in. A world where everything was genetically engineered and individuals were so caught up in corporate consumerism that individuality didn't even exist anymore. And this band was fronted by a black woman.
Some people think little girls should be seen and not heard, but I think, oh, bondage! Up yours! 1, 2, 3, 4!
This was the very short-lived punk band X-Ray Specs. Their leader was Marianne Joan Elliott Said, otherwise known as Polystyrene, a punk kid of Irish and Somalian descent who grew up in Brixton and left school and ran away from home at just 15 years old to pursue a career in the arts. After seeing the Sex Pistols perform at the Pavilion at 19 years old, she decided to form a punk band of her own, which she called X-Ray Specs. What was so special about Polystyrene was how she took the founding principles of DIY punk rock and committed to the do-it-yourself aspect wholeheartedly. She designed all the artwork for the band's albums as well as promotion materials. And instead of dressing up in chains, leather, and spikes, which people expected to see from the punk kids at this point, she rocked shift dresses and neon day-glow synthetic ensembles that she threw together out of random materials and trash. She was also happy to rock her braces and change the colors regularly. In a 1978 interview with New Musical Express, Styrene said, "I had told them I wasn't a sex symbol, and if they tried to make me one, I'd shave my head tomorrow." Her unorthodox style, her anti-posturing attitude, and lack of artifice was an image that she curated just by being her authentic self, and that is perhaps the most rebellious act anybody in entertainment can undergo. That was all it took for her to rail against the corporate image of women in music. But isn't that what punk has always been about? Yes, of course. And I'm not sure if this was intentional or not, but X-Ray Specs most definitely prolonged the life of punk when it was starting to become a caricature of itself. Even their sound went against the typical punk format, driven by saxophone leads instead of heavy guitars. Polystyrene was the type of front woman who was not only ahead of her time, but was simply expressing herself based on the world she observed around her. The album Germ-Free Adolescence could be released today, and none of her ideas would sound dated. All of these conversations we're having even now around philosophy, identity, nonconformity, and capitalism, she was singing about over 40 years ago. On the track Artificial, the lyrics go, this dystopia she envisioned was a pretty on-the-nose foresight of the world that we live in now, where everything unique eventually becomes co-opted and commodified. One could also easily interpret this as the way trends are so often recycled in pop culture. It reminds me of women being treated as disposable in the music industry. My personal favorite track off the album is I Am a Poser, because I think everybody can identify with that sentiment. I've always found the discourse surrounding the idea of posers to be a bit preposterous, because we all suffer from a little bit of imposter syndrome. And besides, who cares if how people look, dress, or act doesn't match people's preconceived notions of what kind of attitude or identity they should have, or their musical taste even. It seems just as ridiculous as the debate on whether or not people should be allowed to wear shirts of bands they don't listen to, like, is it really that deep?
It's a piece of fabric.
On her fashion sense, Polystyrene has always said, clothes are never really you. That's why people wear them. You can create an image with them. They express a certain kind of attitude. They take you away from reality, because reality is pretty boring. She was very conscious of the power she had to curate an image for herself, to transcend reality and quote-unquote normality, which she's right about. It is very boring. And it's always nice to create a fantasy. In a world where appearance is everything, I'm sure Polly knew exactly what it felt like to be judged even within the punk scene, not just for her identity, but for not looking like the stereotypical punk kid.
When you don't wear the normal sort of punk gear, the normal leather and plastic and the hinged together jeans, why not?
Well, because I mean, I just don't think that's what it's about. I mean, I think that's just sort of imitating other people, and I think it should be a form of self-expression, really, and, you know, everybody should just wear what they want to wear and not feel sort of that they have to go to certain shops and buy certain things, you know, like traditions and that.
She didn't care, though, because she knew exactly what she was doing. She took back the original spirit of punk and reinvented what it could be. Polystyrene passed away in 2011, but her influence is extremely visible today with Afropunk acts like Big Joni and the 1865. One of the leaders of Big Joni, Stephanie Phillips, was a co-founder of an all-black festival called the Decolonize Fest, which was created as an exclusive space for black and brown punks who were getting overlooked in the scene and no longer felt represented by the annual Afropunk Festival, which eventually started answering to corporate overlords and became largely co-opted. And musicians like Big Joni are continuing to shake the table and recenter the true spirit of punk that Polystyrene pioneered all her years on the scene. Polystyrene was and is the most exciting person to ever come out of the punk movement. And that doesn't negate the influence of other pioneers like Patti Smith or the Slits, but if there was ever a singular person to recenter the narrative about punk's roots and what made the state of mind that is DIY so exciting, it was polystyrene.